What is ideology? Marx and Engels and the German ideology. I'm Dale Elizabeth Glasgow, and I'm your lecturer for this series. The problem of ideology, therefore, concerns the ways in which ideas of different kinds grip the minds of masses and thereby become a material force. It has also to do with the processes by which new forms of consciousness, new conceptions of the world arise, which move the masses of the people into historical action against the prevailing system. Stuart Hall wrote that. In their 1846 book, The German Ideology, Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels explained the concept of ideology in a number of ways. Although they popularized the term, they were not the first to formulate it. This distinction goes to the French philosopher Antoine, Destutt de Tracy, who in 1796 devised a project to explore a new science that would analyze what he said would be the combination and consequences of ideas and sensations of the generation. In 1803, de Tracy published a four-volume tome called Elements d'Idéologie, which examined ways of thinking, memory, and judgment, and the ways we adjust to movement, habit, and will. De Tracy is mostly associated with French republicanism, but for a time he drew favorable attention from Napoleon Bonaparte, while Napoleon was devising a new constitution. Although he was interested in de Tracy's ideas, that interest did not stop Napoleon from distrusting de Tracy and de Tracy's associates, or from viewing the new concept of ideology as a threat to his autocratic rule. Indeed, Napoleon eventually ridiculed de Tracy and the ideas resting behind ideology as pretentious, as abstract, and not of the real world. Later, as his regime began to collapse, in an effort to disarm his challengers, the Republicans, Napoleon claimed that he had coined the term ideologues, not de Tracy. Then, as Napoleon's reign further descended into chaos, he stepped up his attacks on ideology in the process of condemning all kinds of religious and philosophical thought. It is in this way that the concept of ideology, once a loftily conceived and preeminent concept associated with the science of ideas and with providing a systematic account of the communication of ideas, had its philosophical foundation compromised primarily by its association with not only the brutal republicanism of the French Revolution, but also Napoleon's denigration. Ideology then ceased to refer to the science of ideas and began to refer to the ideas themselves. Indeed, the word became inexorably linked with a body of ideas that were considered erroneous and divorced from the practical realities of political life. So the study of ideology went from a respected, serious, and preeminent concept to one that is today commonly thought of as an exercise in abstract thinking, maintenance of illusory ideas, and worthy of derision and disdain. Marx and Engels on ideology. Against this backdrop, in their classic work of 1846, The German Ideology, Marx and Engels took the negative, oppositional conceptualization of ideology inspired by Napoleon and reappropriated it into a theoretical framework and political program. Accordingly, as a definitional exercise, Marx and Engels' explication of the concept was somewhat scattered and even contradictory in some ways, but their effort was valuable because it offered and continues to offer scholars an opportunity to critically engage the concept of ideology in a way that avoids abstract theory and embraces concreteness and historical specificity. Over a century and a half after The German Ideology was written, the critique of ideology and its relevance to social life remains a central organizing element of Marxist theorizing. Now, for our purposes here, the questions with regard to ideology are fundamentally, what is ideology, and how is ideology important to the study of social life? To the second question of how is ideology important to the study of life, well, although the concept of ideology is often associated with ill-boding forces, there continues to be an ever-evolving understanding of ideology and the role that it plays in our social, political, and cultural lives. And this increases the prospects for social change. In other words, understanding how ideologies operate in the world allows individuals to understand and challenge assumptions about social life, raising the prospect for revolutionary change. Now to the first question of what is ideology? To be ideological is most often associated with mental representations that reside in individuals' consciousness that concern what the individual believes to be the truth of how the world works and what has value. This is the classic non-politicized definition of ideology as de Tracy originally formulated it. Now let's look at an example of ideology. Racism. The philosopher Tommy Shelby and others have argued that racism is at least partly an ideology, but he noted that there are disagreements as to what that actually means. To interrogate this further, we could ask ourselves what makes an ideology specifically racist. We could also try to decipher the origins of racial ideologies. We could both determine the current content and function of racist ideology and with what mechanism it is interrelated and reproduced. To what extent can racial antagonism be attributed to this ideology and what effect results? Finally, we could determine to what extent can racist ideologies be explained within the framework of, say, for instance, economic factors. Shelby argued that the charge of being ideological, just like the charge of being racist, is associated with social practices or institutions. To clarify a little bit further, let's look at the thought of Barbara J. Fields. In the book, Region, Race, and Reconstruction, Essays in Honor of C. Vann Woodward, the historian Barbara J. Fields argues that the assumption that race is an observable physical fact, a thing, rather than a notion, is profoundly and in its very essence ideological. In her essay, she gives the example of the U.S. Census Bureau classifying Hispanic or Latino as an ethnicity while classifying white, black, and Asian as races. As a justification, the Census Bureau has long asserted that while Hispanic individuals share a common language, they originate from different countries, they are physically distinct from each other, and possess different cultures. Fields argues that the census classification is wholly dependent upon the ideological predisposition of the census-determining body. She writes, "But on that reasoning, black and white Americans constitute an ethnic group. They are originally from different countries. They certainly do not all look alike, but they share a language. What about Asians? They are not of a single physical type, and they too come from different countries. Adhering to common usage, it is hard to see how they can be classed as either a single race or a single ethnic group. They do not all share either a language or a culture. Then what about blacks? They do not all look alike. They came from originally different countries. They spoke different languages and had different cultures. In the heyday of the Atlantic slave trade, both traders and their customers understood that the cargoes of the slave ships included Africans of different national, cultural, and linguistic backgrounds. Slave-buying planters talked in voluble, if no doubt misguided, detail about the varied characteristics of Caramantes, Mandingos, Fulas, Congos, Angolas, Igbos, Widas, Nagos, Papas, and Gaboons. Experienced buyers and sellers could distinguish them by sight and speech, and prices would vary accordingly. Black people, in other words, were initially no more a racial group than Hispanics. In the era of the slave trade, a social fact that these people all came from the same exotic continent and that they all were destined for slavery made the similarities among them more important in principle than the differences. Their subsequent experience in slavery, particularly in its mainland North American form, eventually caused the similarities to overwhelm the differences in reality as well. Finally, Fields' thesis statement is that ideas about color, like ideas about anything else, derive their importance, indeed their very definition, from their context. They can no more be the unmediated reflex of psychic impressions than can any other ideas. It is ideological context that tells people which details to notice, which to ignore, and which to take for granted in translating the world around them into ideas about the world. Ideologies embedded in lived experience. Marx and Engels' conception of ideology was problematic because it was contradictory, as I mentioned, and this was in many parts of their work. Nevertheless, in the German ideology, at least tangentially, Marx and Engels did not conceive of human beings as automatons, robots, driven blindly, without thought, by physical need or automatic stimulus. They noted that the historical process is replete with the production of new needs by human beings. In other words, for Marx and Engels, the material life process is not one devoid of thought. On the contrary, it is a human practice, a process permeated with thought and consciousness. They believed that ideologies must be analyzed within the context of whole life activity, as opposed to being treated autonomously. Marx and Engels looked to ideology as being rooted in the social, the political, and cultural conditions of the life world. In the German ideology, they wrote, "Morality, religion, metaphysics, all the rest of ideology, and their corresponding forms of consciousness, thus no longer retain the semblance of independence. They have no history, no development. But men, developing their material production and their material intercourse, alter, along with this their real existence, their thinking, and the products of their thinking. Life is not determined by consciousness, but consciousness by life. In the first method of approach, the starting point is consciousness, taken as the living individual. In the second method, which conforms to real life, it is the real living individuals themselves, and consciousness is considered solely as their consciousness." I'm Bill Elizabeth Glasgow. Thanks for watching. Please like and subscribe.